Good morning, Echo.
Woo!
Go ahead, come on in, come on in.
Come
you guys can walk
in.
Through the curves. We're so excited that service is starting.
Yes, who's come excited on. To be back in the building? Let me hear it.
I am so
okay,
excited.
Okay, that was really weak. Come on, who is excited to be back in the building? Come
wow,
on.
Wow.
You guys, are you guys asleep?
I think we're going to have to wait until maybe they all come in. Maybe they might not have heard us.
I know, but they're definitely going to wake up when worship hits.
Yeah,
so
come on. Well, hey, we're so excited that you're all here with us for our in-person services. Man,
yes.
We couldn't be more thrilled that you guys are here. I just wanted to take a second, welcome our Cranberry campus, you guys that are all here
come
with
on.
Us in person, our Newcastle campus that is starting their services right now, as well as our online community. Man, we couldn't be more excited that you guys are joining us online or in person this weekend. So I'll try this one more time because I think we kind of got you guys all in here. Who's excited to be back in the building this morning? Come on. Man, so pumped. Well, hey, we're going to start off with a little bit of fun, but I'm going to need two volunteers, okay?
So go ahead,
raise your hands. You right there in the gray. And all the way in the back. Come on up. Can we give him a hand? You guys can come on up on stage. Just take those stairs right there. Give him a hand. What's your name, bud?
Jer.
And what's your name? Jalen. Okay.
Jer and Jalen. Come on, can we give it up for them? So good. All right, so what you're going to do, go ahead, grab a pool noodle and a balloon. Just one, okay? And do y'all see these little pink lines that are on the stage, these pink strips here, okay? You have to stay inside that box. That's your box. You can't go up top. You can't go outside of the box, but you're outside. Dude, you're going to lose right now, man. You're outside of the box. You got to come in. There you go. Okay. So what we're going to do on the count of three, I'm going to count you down. You're going to throw the balloon up in the air, and you got to keep it up with just your pool noodle. No hands, no other body parts. If it falls off the stage, if it hits the floor, if it hits back here, you're out. All right, we're gonna do best of three. There might be some defense. You might have to go after the other person's balloon. You never know. It could get really intense. And I need your guys' help to help cheer
yes.
them on, okay? So here we go on the count of three. One, two, three, throw it up.
Let's go.
All right, here we go.
Let's get this music
can
up.
Dump that music. You're about cheer to fall out of the box. You're about to fall out of the box. Be careful.
Uh-oh.
Oh man. You guys, you're just focusing on your own. Interesting strategy, interesting tactic. I get it.
Uh-oh.
Coming in for the kill. Oh, no!
Oh!
All right, it's 1-0. 1-0. Best of three. There's redemption. You ready? Okay, here we go. 1-2-3. Throw it up. Come on, here we go. Come on. Oh man, it's getting tight. Wow. Okay, you can't rest it on your pool noodle. That's a good tactic, though. It's a good tactic. Okay, I like it. You kind of used your head there, but I'll let it go this one time. All right. You might have to go after the other person's balloon. You never know. It's a sword. It could turn into a sword fight. Anything could happen. Oh man, it almost hit me.
Uh-oh!
Can somebody grab that for me? Bring it back up here real quick, please. Okay, we don't have to fight over it. I promise. All right. One. Last round. Best of three. Here we go. 1-2-3. Throw it up. Come on, let me hear. Can you guys make some noise up for them?
Come on.
Guys.
Come on.
Woo!
Woo!
Oh, man. Really excited.
Oh
no!
It's getting crazy.
You can go after each other's balloons.
Yeah,
that's totally okay.
Each other.
I mean, it might cost you. It might cost you the game. It really might. You never know. Uh-oh.
Go after his balloon?
Oh man. Okay, we'll hold into it. Might have to try that one more time. Get it out. All right, I'm going to start counting down from 10, and you're going to have to end it in the next 10. Oh, no. Oh, man.
The recovery. Get him.
Oh. This is crazy. This is absolutely nuts. This is all right, intense. I'm going to count down from 10 seconds. It's going to have to end, so you got to get aggressive. Here we go. 10, help me count. 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4,
three, two, one.
We have a winner.
Give it up. Let's give it up for Jaylen.
Come on. I can take that from you.
You guys both did a great job. Thank you.
You guys can go ahead. Have a seat. Thank you so much for participating. I appreciate it. So Mariah, what do we got going on this summer?
All right. We have 8 weeks of summer approaching. Who's pumped for summer? Come on. I know I am. I'm excited. But we are so excited for our summer experience here at Echo on the weekends. And we don't want you guys to miss it. Even though we will not be having small groups throughout the summer, we have amazing things planned for you guys. So keep coming to our weekend services and keep inviting your friends. And if you need more information or more updates, you can just follow us on Instagram and find out at echo.com. Victory.
Yeah, come on. Well, hey, if you've been around in our family for any length of time, you know that Kingdom Builders is part of our culture. It's living to give. It's giving beyond the four walls of our church and giving above your normal tithes. But man, Pastor Ben said it best, so take a look at this short video.
I want to talk about the vision for Kingdom Builders. Kingdom Builders is building and expanding the kingdom, reaching more faster. This is one of the most life-changing things that we've ever done as a church. Kingdom Builders, simply put, is a giving framework that creates a simple but impacting approach for our church to make an impact and live beyond our walls. It brings awareness to what we're doing for God and provides a reporting system that keeps global missions, the local church expansion, and investing in future leaders before you as the church. It's designed to connect God's people with the calling upon their lives to actually be a Kingdom Builders. This year, Student Ministries is committed to help support A21. A21 is a nonprofit organization fueled by the radical hope that human beings everywhere will be rescued from bondage and completely restored. Their mission is to abolish slavery everywhere, forever. It's living the give and it's making an impact. We are Kingdom Builders. Because of our generosity, we're also going to help support Kathy Moore Ministries, which will be funding a pastor's conference, partnering with local pastoral leaders to facilitate a regional conference to help pastors in the Dominican Republic. These conferences will be interdenominational to foster unity among the leaders that would include training and materials. Lastly, we're gonna help support SOZO missions for juniors and seniors, funding our SOZO junior and seniors to go on a missions trip and to get outside of the four walls of the church. We have been called as followers of Jesus to be generous. It's more blessed to give than it is to receive, and you can make an impact. What's my part in Kingdom Builders? Become a Kingdom Builder with a yearly financial commitment above our regular giving. Let's embrace God until the world knows. Join us as Kingdom Builders as we together multiply God's kingdom.
Yes. Woo! Come on.
Isn't that awesome? So good. All right,
so
we're about to go into a time of tithe and offering. We are going to go to 2 Corinthians 9, verse 10. It will be on the screen right behind me. It says, "Now he who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will supply and multiply your seed for sowing and increase the harvest of your righteousness." So Paul is the writer of 2 Corinthians in this scripture. And who is Paul talking about? Who is Paul talking about to be our supplier? He's talking about God, right? He's talking about how God is our supplier. He is our source, and he wants to increase your harvest. So in knowing that, in knowing this scripture, we can be so confident that God wants to supply our every need in our school, in our families, and even in church. So we can have a generous heart knowing that we lack absolutely nothing. So as we go into tithes and offerings, let's just remember how God has generously blessed us. So if you could just bow your heads with me, and we're going to pray over our tithes. Dear Heavenly Father, I just thank you so much for every single person in this room, Lord. I thank you for just the special gifts and callings that are on their life, Lord, and that you're able just to reveal your generosity to them and how you want to take care of every single need that they have. And we are able to have a generous overflow out of it.
In Jesus' mighty name, amen, amen.
Amen, amen. Well, hey, I think y'all know what is coming next. So go ahead, come on, stand on up. You guys can come up front for worship. If it makes you comfortable, you're more than welcome to stand in your seats as well. But if you want, you can join us. We're just gonna have a lot of energy. Just spend some time praising God. I encourage you as we go throughout worship, just take your next step, whatever that looks like for you, whether that's just dancing or singing or praising or doing whatever that is. We're gonna have a ton of fun just worshiping our Jesus this morning. Here we go.
All right, keep your hands up and let's just sing this out together. Give all of our praise to Jesus. Sing it out.
Staring into your eyes makes my heart come alive. Suddenly brought to life when I met you. Reaching beyond the skies, running deep, stretching wide. Perfect love realized. Go, never let go. Oh, it's more than just words, love beyond my control, out of control.
Hands up.
This is real love. This is real love.
Louder than the unbelief. I carries a hallelujah. My weapon is a melody. I raise a hallelujah. Heaven comes to fight for me.
Feels good to worship our God corporately together again, right? You guys feeling good out there? Well, hey, we got one more song that we're just going to go into. I just encourage you, as we step through this song, just to really press in. Take your next step, whatever that is. Lift your hands, lift your voices, and just sing out our praises to our Heavenly Father.
It's time for the sleeper to wake. It's time for the old winds to change. I hear the Spirit say it's time to worship you. It's time for the dead man to rise. It's time for the gray light to shine. Oh, I hear the Spirit say it's time, yes. Fling wide you heavenly gates. Let the King of glory in. Let the King of glory in. Come right in on your people's praise. Let the King of glory in. Let the King of glory in. Yeah. It's time for the sleeper to wake. It's time for the old winds to take.
Open up the windows.
over these last several weeks, we've been going through these crazy times, right? We've been going through this pandemic over the last 11, 12 weeks, right? And during that time, maybe you're feeling that there's like a bit of a darkness that has settled, or just a spirit of depression or a spirit of anxiety that has settled on top of your life during this time. Maybe you've been lonely during this time. Maybe you've been missing people, missing connection, missing church, right? But I got a word to encourage you today, and that's John 1, verse 5. It says, if there's darkness in a room and light enters into that room, it extinguishes the dark. The dark cannot exist when there is light in the room. And our King, the King of all kings, the Lord of all glory, is that light. And he is in this room tonight. He is in this room this morning. His presence is overtaking this room. As we sing these words, as we lift the praises up to him, sing these words out to him. Sing his praises. Give him all of the honor, all of the glory, all of the praise. Come on, lift your voice. Heavenly Father, Lord, we just thank you, Jesus, that we get to come in a place where we just get to worship you, Father. We just get to worship your holy, matchless name, Lord. There is no one like you, Jesus. We thank you for your grace, Lord. We thank you for your mercy and your love every day. In Jesus' name, come on, we all say amen. Well, hey, you guys can go ahead, take a seat. Thank you so much for worshiping with us. We love you guys. I know I've missed those corporate times of worship so much. I'm so excited that we could just share them with you. As we continue to step in through our service here, Pastor Ben Archer has an incredible message, an incredible word for you. So I encourage you, lean in, take notes, and take a look at this.
Echo, welcome home. How's everybody feeling today? Come on, it feels so good to be in the house of God, praising God corporately. You know, I just want to take a second. I want to remind you that you belong and your family. Guys, I love you so much. I'm Pastor Ben, in case you've forgotten or you're tuning in online. And I just wanted to take a second and I wanted to say welcome home. Gosh, it just feels so good. This is amazing. And I've missed you all so much. Come on, did you miss me? There's a little bit of pause there. All right. Hey, look, you know, we've said through this whole entire time that we are one church in thousands of locations. And so we've got two physical locations. So right now, the Cranberry campus, come on, make some noise again, Cranberry. And And those of you that are in Newcastle and maybe you're tuning in online all over the United States in America, we've had people tuning in and it's just been awesome streaming in online. So if you're watching online right now, if you could go ahead and like the stream that you're watching and then comment, share with us where you're tuning in from. Let's see in the comment section and then go ahead and send it. Share that stream to someone so we can encourage them and share the gospel with them. Amen. Come on, somebody. It's good. I'm just excited that we can be together in person. You know, in case you've missed out on where we've been as a community and what we've been talking about for the last few weeks, you can always get caught up on YouTube at Victory Students. It's the white logo with the V. Go and find it, subscribe, click the bell so you get the content that's coming out consistently. But we're super excited and there's a keynote. You know, we got friends up here with us because note takers are history makers, right? So I want to encourage you today, friends, to take notes. Note takers are history makers. In fact, if you're one that's really good at taking notes and you're doing it digitally, please share it to Instagram and tag us at echo.victory so we can bring our online community up with us and encourage what God's doing in our community. Does that sound good? It's good stuff. Hey, let's go ahead. Let's open up our Bibles to John 13. John 13. And while you're turning to John 13, 34, I want to remind you why we exist as a church and a youth group. You know, we exist to help all people realize that God loves them unconditionally. God loves you unconditionally. It's true. And every time that we get together, every time we worship in person and we go through small groups and we go through the message, all of that, I believe that you get the tools and the resources to grow in a right relationship with Jesus. In other words, I believe you begin to know God. I believe that. Now today, a crucial detail for you, for those of you that are watching online, is we do not have small groups after service for those that are online. And those of us that are in person, we're going to be in groups. So if you're watching online and you don't know, well, what group would I go to? I encourage you, join in person. Come to one of our two locations so you can get plugged into your small group. And come this fall, in August, we're going to be launching e-groups. I'm just very excited for it. We're launching e-groups come the end of August. So our friends on the online community can join in with us. It's good. So good. But today we're going to be talking about how to love people best. I believe this is a timely message. I believe it's something that we need in our community and in our family. And so that's what we're going to be talking about today. So John 13, 34. Go ahead and get there. And I just want to read this. This is Jesus talking. Now Jesus said, "A new command I give you, love one another. As I have loved you, so you must love one another. By this, everyone will know that you're my disciples, if you love one another." This is so powerful. Now, what we're going to talk about today is how Jesus modeled loving people and some ways that we can love people. And he did it through serving. But one of the things that I just wanted to bring to our attention is if you reverse this for a second. What if we said it this way? What if we said this verse this way? If you hate someone, you are so far from God. I don't know, have you ever been guilty for saying, "I hate someone"? Oh, I hate so-and-so. Anybody? Come on, we're in church. Am I the only one that's been there? You know what I'm saying? And so we've all been there. But I got to tell you that in that moment, when you say that I hate someone, you're actually so far from God. You couldn't be further. Jesus said it. Jesus said it there, that if you love one another, they will know that you're my disciples, that you're my followers. And so we're going to talk about how we can love people best today by serving them. And before I go any further, I just want to go ahead. We're going to bow our heads and we're going to pray. And I just come with that expectation today that God's going to show up and show off. Amen? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we just thank you today. We thank you for your word, that it's a lamp to our feet, a light to our path, that it helps us and guides us and teaches us and ministers to us, Lord. And I thank you for opening our eyes so we can see you, Jesus. Open our ears so we can hear you, Holy Spirit. Let us see people the way that you do, God. Let us have your heart, and whatever breaks your heart, God, let it break ours. And Lord, we just thank you that we're going to leave encouraged with our head held high. In Jesus' mighty name, everyone said today, amen and amen. Go ahead and drop that in the comments. Say amen. Type it in there. Hey, look, just real quick by a show of hands, let me see your hand if you're someone that has been to church camp. Let me see your hand real quick. Okay. Okay, many of us, if you've been to church camp, go ahead, put in the comments that that's me, haul at your boy, whatever. And so maybe you've been to somewhere where it's been called VBS, Vacation Bible School. Anybody know what I'm talking about? So when I was growing up, I used to go to Vacation Bible School. Now, the way that ours was modeled is basically 3 days in, we would then have a family night. Everybody would get together. We would eat. Holla at your boy. We'd eat. And anybody eat some really good things or over quarantine? You know what I'm saying? Like maybe a little bit too much sugar, somebody. Like that's been me, guilty, quarantine 30. Like holla at your boy, you know? But we'd get together, we'd eat. And now the way that our church was set up is we had a basement in the bottom of the church. And then the parking lot was super long. And then all the way at the end of the church, we had a pavilion. So far out there. Now, we all came early, my family and some other families, to help the pastor set up for the family night. And when we got there, he had a setting up table. So we had to carry tables from the basement across the parking lot to the pavilion, set them up. And now, I don't know if you've ever helped somebody set up for a graduation party. Anybody ever been there? Graduation party? Let me see if you've helped in the comments for a graduation party. But if you've helped, you know, like carrying tables, it's exhausting. Well, for me, we didn't have plastic tables that weighed 5 pounds. We had the old wooden ones with like the metal rim. I don't know if you know what I'm talking about, but they're heavy. They're monsters. They're like 60 pounds. And so after carrying them 4 or 5 trips, you just get exhausted. Fatigue sets in. And I'm like, God gave me noodles. I don't know what to do about it. It's just what I got. I got noodles, right? And then we had to set up chairs. We had all these aluminum chairs and everybody's carrying 3 in each hand, total of 6, but I'm carrying 1 in each hand. Holla at your boy. I'm tired, right? It's been a little bit. And so finally the pastor comes out of the church and he yells, he's like, hey, help! Somebody come in and help. Anybody free? Can you help me? And so I'm like, immediately, I just dropped the 2 chairs. It's right there. I'm like, I'm done. I'm barely lifting up my arm. I'm like a T-Rex. Me, I'm good. I'll come help. And so I go to help the pastor and we go downstairs. We're in the basement. Now, when I walk in, he's got this utility room, and he's got a mop, he's got a bucket, he's pouring bleach into it, and he looks at me, and he's like, son, you can do it. And I'm like, yeah, I know. No, he's like, no, you can do it. I'm praying for you. It's going to be okay. You got this. And I'm like, am I good? Like, are we good? I'm getting a little bit nervous right now. And so then we go, and he walks up to the bathroom, and ever so slowly, he just like opens up this door, and it's like, and I look in, and lo and behold, what do I see with my own 2 eyes? It's like a war zone in there. It's a mess.
Well, what are you talking about, Pastor Ben? Like, what do you mean?
You know what I mean. You know what it was. Like the commode had backed up. It blew up. It's on the walls. It's on the mirrors. I'm like, oh my gosh, what is this smell? It's horrific. And I'm like, God, I can't do this. I can't do that. I'm like freaking out inside, right? And he's like, no, you got this. In Jesus' name, you can do all things through Christ who strengthens you. I'm like, whoo, Jesus, help me. But what had happened was the septic tank backed up, and it just made a crazy mess, and so I was the guy. You know, growing up, I always had this posture. I always had this attitude that I'm not above any job. I'm not above any task. I'm not above any person. There's nothing too low that I'm here to serve. That was my attitude. It's a posture that I personally just take. I guess you could say it's part of my character and that I'm not above anything. I'm here to serve. See, when you live a life to serve, you start to do what seems fit. You'll do whatever it is. And maybe you even have that feeling that I'm not above anything. I'm not above anyone. I'm here to serve. There's no job too low for me. Paul said this. He said, I've been crucified with Christ. It's no longer that I live, but that Christ lives in me and through me. See, Jesus, though he was rich, he became poor. Though he had it all, he gave it all. Though he was a king, he became a servant. And Jesus was the servant of all. So I'm going to give you 3 things today, 3 things to write down if you're taking notes, and I hope that you are. 3 things that Jesus did to love people and to love them well. Go ahead, write down 1. He descended to greatness. Jesus descended to greatness. Didn't Jesus like ascend up into heaven? Like, wait a second, Pastor Ben. What do you, but first, he descended down to serve you and I. His very character is, I'm not above any job. I'm not above any person. Jesus became a servant. See, the gateway or the pathway to greatness is through being a servant. God's math works differently than ours. God's always working opposite of our culture. Watch how God does it. The Bible says that the first shall be last. That the greatest of all is the servant of all. That the best faith or the greatest faith is childlike faith. God's math works differently than our math. I don't know about you, but I want to live a life that says that I'm not above any task, I'm not above any place, I'm not above any person. I'm actually willing to descend down into greatness no matter what it is and serve. And serve. I'm willing to wash your feet. And I believe that the greatest of all is the servant of all. In fact, the Bible says in Matthew that just as the Son of Man didn't come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom to many. Come on, we got to descend to greatness. Amen? You could go ahead and write down number two today. Jesus came to serve the one. Jesus came to serve the one. See, we make the biggest impacts through the smallest acts. It says so much about Jesus in the ones that he served. I get so mesmerized, I get so moved that Jesus, our God, stopped for the one. He stopped for one man with a sick child. He stopped for one man with a withered hand. He stopped for one woman that was bent over. He stopped for one man, one woman who had a lot of demons in her, right? He stopped for one man who had a sick mother. Jesus always stopped for the one. Jesus was never above the one. When we serve the one, we make the biggest difference in this world, the biggest impact in this world by serving the one. You will make the hugest impact in the smallest acts of service. There's millions of people in Pittsburgh. There's 40,000 people in Cranberry Township. There's 20,000 in Newcastle. How are we going to make a difference? How are we going to serve all these people? I'll tell you, it's one at a time. It's one at a time. It's your neighbor next to you. It's one person at a time. It's one serve day at a time. It's one act of kindness in your neighborhood. Did you know that during COVID-19, when we were locked down in quarantine, that student ministries, Echo, we wrote 1,100 letters to nursing homes. Did you know that? That's amazing. That's amazing. We brought hope to the hopeless. Did you know that every single week, Echo students showed up to serve at Help Your Neighbor? And we gave away over 50,000 meals, still giving them away. It's amazing. But it starts with one at a time. It starts with loving the person next to you and serving them no matter what. I remember when I was young and I got on fire for God. I was like so in, and there was this dude in my friend circle that like, he was just a little bit different. He talked different. He looked different. He acted different, but he was the kindest, sweetest person. And to be honest with you, our friend group took advantage of him. And I remember that God just put him on my heart and I began to serve this guy. Like, he couldn't do anything for me, but I could do a lot for him. When was the last time God put somebody on your radar and you just began to serve that person? When was the last time you asked God, who should be on my radar? And you just plug in and you begin to serve this person. See, when that one person, it could be in passing. It could be at a graduation party coming up. It could be in the grocery store. It could be in your neighborhood. I hope that we are a church and a youth group that we're looking to take it one by one and serve the person next to us and to love the people next to us. Anybody looking to make a difference? Say that that's me. Come on. Just Mariah in the room. Come on, if you're online and that's you, go ahead and shout out amen. Say, come on, preach it. Come on, team. Is that you? Anybody looking to make a difference? So many of us, we miss out on the opportunity because we're looking for some huge moment in life. We're looking to give away our pair of shoes and or our shirt off our back or our jacket, and all of a sudden somebody just magically has a camera, right? And they capture the moment, and there's 13 million views, there's 13 million likes, there's 13 million hearts on TikTok. Like, just people going crazy. We're looking for some big moment in life when the big moments are actually in the little acts of service. starts with the small things. We make the biggest impacts through the smallest acts. Make an impact. You can make an impact right now. You can do that today. And we're going to close with this, our third thought, and the worship team's going to come out. They're going to join me. And Jesus was always willing to stop. Could write that down. Jesus was always willing to stop. See, Jesus, he was always going and going and going. And I pray that everything that you do on purpose. There's nothing worse than someone who lives life without purpose. That if you're a neighbor, you're a neighbor on purpose. If you're a sibling, you're a sibling on purpose. When you're in school, you're a student on purpose. When you show up into this room, you're taking the posture of a student. You're a student on purpose. When you serve someone, love someone, you're doing life on purpose wherever you're at. But I pray that on your going, that you're not someone that's so addicted to going that you miss out and you're not willing to stop. Because Jesus, he was going to Jericho and he was going to this spot and that spot and he was going all through Judea. But he was always willing to stop. It says so much about you and what you're willing to stop for. What are you willing to cancel your plans for? What are you willing to say, you know what, my day is done. I'm going to stop, I'm going to serve them, I'm going to help them, whatever it looks like. What are you willing to stop for? What situation are you willing to say, you know what, my whole day is done? Maybe you see this homeless woman outside of Walmart and you stop and you take a moment. You know, we have a student in seventh grade that right before the quarantine, right before we shut down, this is so amazing, he went to dinner with his family. And so while they were at dinner, And they're going through, everybody's ordering their food, and his family didn't hear him order his food. But when he ordered his food, he said, can I get mine in a to-go box? And so they bring out all of the food, and this is one of our own students, and so when he gets his food, it's literally, it's there, it's in front of him. He gets up, takes his box, and walks right out the door. Because when he walked in, he walked past somebody that was homeless. And he walked over and gave his food to that person. What is it for you that says, I'm willing to stop. I'm willing to make a difference. I'm willing to love the person next to me. Jesus, he has all of his disciples. He's got them all around and they're asking him some questions and they're like, who do I stop for? Who is it that I stop for, Jesus? And Jesus goes, oh gosh, all right, guys. Oh man, my disciples. Just kidding, I don't know if he talked like that. I just imagine him, he would have to beat up these guys a little bit to get their butts in gear, right? But he's like, okay, how am I gonna do this? How am I gonna give you an illustration here, an example. He goes, okay, there's this one dude. He's on a journey. He's going somewhere. And there's a thief, a thug. He shows up. He beats him up real good, leaves him for dead. He's on the side of the road. He's dead. So this guy comes up. And while he's coming up, he sees him. And he goes like this. Oh, dang. Bro, you in rough shape. Looks around and just keeps on going. You ever see someone who's hurting and in need? They're broken and you don't know what to do, so you look the other way? Anybody? It's happened to us all, right? And then Jesus says there's a second guy. He comes up, he sees him, looks around, sees what's going on, but keeps on going. Then the third guy, we know the third guy is the Good Samaritan. He shows up, sees him, takes care of his wounds, helps him, puts him up in the hotel, motel, Holiday Inn. Like, he's set. He's good. Stops and serves this man. His day, his plans, he was going somewhere. It's all changed. It's all wrecked. To serve someone and love him. He's willing to stop. See, in essence, this is the spirit. This is the very spirit of Jesus. Jesus, when you were in your spot, when you were in your state and your brokenness and your distress, Jesus stopped. He didn't walk past you and I. He stopped to take care of our wounds and our bills and to set you free. Jesus did that. Let's be thankful that Jesus wasn't too busy to walk past you and I. Jesus was always willing to stop. Always willing to stop. He didn't just stop for the one. He didn't just stop for the crowds. He stopped for the one. And I tell you today that Jesus said, when you do this unto the least of these, you've done it unto me. We need to slow down, and we need to be people to love one another, to love people, to serve them, and to help them. Because I'll tell you this right now, you will never see healing happen in someone's life unless you slow down to serve them. You will never see healing happen, ever. Translation, serving someone takes what the devil has stained people with. Addictions, brokenness, hurts, despair, racism, all of that stuff. When you stop and you begin to serve your neighbor and you love them, you will change people one by one. I promise you, Jesus did it. I promise you, we got to see people the way that Jesus does. And I pray that you'd be willing to descend to greatness and serve people. We're not above anything. We're not above anyone. I'm looking to be a Jesus in skin. Will you help me? Will you help me be a Jesus in skin? Here we are. We're not too busy. I'm not too busy for a phone call. How about you? I'm not too busy for a text message. How about you? I'm not too busy to show up to my other Christian group and to help them. How about you? We're not too busy because if we are, if we don't stop, we will miss out on the opportunity to serve one that could bring healing in the midst of their brokenness. Let's be a Jesus in skin. I'm not above it. How about you? Let's love people by serving them. I'm going to go ahead. I'm going to pray for us right now. And if you've never made Jesus Christ Lord and Savior of your life, I'm going to give you that opportunity. Maybe for you today, serving people is your next step. Loving people like Jesus. Maybe for you, it's coming to Jesus and making Him Lord and Savior of your life. So right now, everywhere that you are, all around this room, if you bow your heads, those of you that are watching online, if you would bow your heads wherever you're at, whatever room you're in, whoever's around you, we're all going to bow our heads because we don't want to distract from what God wants to do. If you've never made Jesus Christ Lord and Savior of your life, right now, what we're going to do is we're going to say a prayer. We're all going to pray out loud, all of us. And I'm going to ask those of you that are in the room with me that if you want to make Jesus Christ Lord and Savior of your life, that you raise your hand. If that's you, I'm going to ask in a moment that you raise your hand. Those of you that are online, in a moment I'm going to ask that you physically say out loud, that's me, Pastor Ben. That's me. See, because Jesus said this. Jesus said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. And that no man comes to the Father except through me. In fact, the Bible says in Romans 10, 9 through 10, that if you declare with your mouth, meaning if you speak, we're about to pray together, if you speak out loud that Jesus is Lord and you believe in your heart that God raised Him from the dead, that you'll be saved. So right now, wherever you are, if you're in this room, let me see your hands right now if you want to make Jesus Christ Lord and Savior of your life. Amen. I see that hand. Amen. I see those hands. Amen. Amen. You can put your hands down. Amen. Amen. And those of you that are online, say out loud physically, that's me, Pastor Ben. And what we're going to do right now is everyone, everywhere, we're going to pray out loud, loud enough where you can hear it. Say it where you hear it and repeat after me. Father God, I come to you in Jesus' name. And I believe with all my heart that Jesus, you're the Son of God. And you died on the cross for my sins. I receive you to be my Lord, and I'm a child of God, and I'll never be the same. In Jesus' mighty name, everyone said, amen and amen. Congratulations. Come on. It's a party right now. You can go ahead and type online, amen. It's a celebration. I encourage you to write down today's date as your brand new birthday. All of heaven is rejoicing with you right now. It's amazing. Look, if you've made that decision, I've got a 14-day devotional for you. And you can text the word CHANGE to 97,000 97,000. And maybe you're like, Pastor Ben, I don't have a phone. Well, tell your small group leader, because I've got that 14-day devotional we can give you in paper form. And my friends that are watching online, make it to one of our two campuses, one of our two locations, and we'll get that to you and in your hands. We're just so excited. So right now, right now we're getting ready to go to small groups. And like I said, friends online, we do not have small groups tonight. We'll be starting those up in August. So please make it to one of our campuses to join a group. It's where we find freedom. It's the most important part of our service. So before we go to small groups, what I want to do is I want to acknowledge all of our eighth graders. All of our eighth graders. If you're an eighth grader in the room, can I just see your hand? Yes, amen, amen. Awesome. And so what I'd like to do, friends, if you're comfortable, I'd like you to come up. And what I want to do is I want to lay hands on you, because the Bible says that when I lay hands on you, that there's a spiritual impartation. If you're comfortable with that, if you'd come up so I can pray for you and lay hands on you, only my eighth graders, come on up, and I'm going to come down. You don't have to come up if you're not comfortable, but I'm going to pray for you and everyone else. What we're going to do is we're going to stretch our hands towards them. We're going to stretch our hands towards them, and friends, we're going to do that because we're in agreement with the prayer that I'm going to pray over them. And we're believing that God is going to show up in Jesus' mighty name. Amen? That there's a spiritual deposit for this next step and this next season in their life as they're going to go to Sozo tonight, on Wednesday night. You guys ready for Sozo? Come on, it's good. It's good. Yeah, the ninth grade. I'm sorry, y'all ninth grade, right? Ninth grade, eighth grade going in the ninth. Okay, I'm praying for our eighth graders going in the ninth grade. I'll pray for you anyway. It's okay. It's okay. But who's our eighth grade going in the ninth? Okay, that's okay, girls. Stay up. Receive the double portion. Amen. Let's go. I'm just going to go ahead and pray for you. In the name of Jesus, come on, friends, let's stretch out. In the name of Jesus, we just thank you for blessing them. Everywhere the soles of their feet touch will be blessed, God. We thank you that they are your children. God, I thank you that they've made it this far. Lord, I thank you that you've protected their hearts. You protect their eyes and their ears, God. I thank you for mighty men and mighty women of God. Holy Spirit, I thank you for a spiritual deposit upon their lives for this next season of their life as they're moving up in the name of Jesus. We thank you, Lord, that they are blessed going in and they're blessed going out in the name of Jesus Christ. Everyone said together, amen and amen. Come on, somebody, let's give it up. So right now, we're going to small groups, the most important part of our service. I love y'all.